Hello friends, it is Dr. Alsop here, and we are going to spend the next few minutes discussing the ventricles of the brain and what they secrete, which is cerebrospinal fluid. So major learning objectives for this session include defining cerebrospinal fluid, CSF. So what does it do? Where is it located? Where is it secreted from? So we'll cover all of that, as well as discussing the ventricular system, which are really just hollow spaces within the brain. All right, so let's talk cerebrospinal fluid. CSF is composed of substances from blood plasma. It's primarily water, but there are other substances in there as well. It's going to be secreted by what's referred to as choroid plexuses. And these are networks of modified blood capillaries that are located in the walls of the ventricle. So these pink areas on this ventricular model are supposed to be representing the choroid plexuses. CSF will be located in the ventricles as it is secreted, but it will also circulate slowly and continuously in the subarachnoid space. That space that is going to be between the pia mater and the arachnoid mater. So this is that subarachnoid space here. Functions of the CSF include shock absorption, so think helping the brain not hit the bone with movement. It's going to help kind of reduce that weight of the brain, and it's also going to provide an optimal chemical environment for neuronal signaling. Okay, so let's talk ventricles. I'm always a little bit amazed by ventricles because they're literally spaces within the brain where CSF is produced and through which it flows to get towards the subarachnoid space. It's also where within those walls you'll have those choroid plexuses, which is the site of CSF formation, excuse me. Okay, so let's talk about the ventricles. There are four ventricles. There will be two lateral ventricles, which are really just your first and second ventricles, and these occupy a fairly large area within the cerebral hemispheres. And you can see in this corpus callosum region here, this little dark area where you're entering into the hollow lateral ventricle. CSF will drain from the lateral ventricles into the interventricular foramina, of which there are two, so one for each lateral ventricle. So they will go from the interventricular foramina into the third ventricle. The third ventricle will be located in the middle of the diencephalon. So this is one side of the diencephalon. The other side would be on the other part of the hemisected brain. You'd put those together, and that space in between would be the third ventricle. The third ventricle is going to drain via the cerebral aqueduct into the fourth ventricle, which lies between the brainstem, so posterior to the brainstem, and here is the cerebellum here. So this will be your fourth ventricle. You can visualize the flow from the lateral ventricles on with all these really nice arrows that I've created. So you can see lateral ventricles into the interventricular foramina, into that third ventricle. The third ventricle, the CSF will flow through the cerebral aqueduct into the fourth ventricle, and I want to focus on this area right here. What happens after the fourth ventricle? So it can do one of four things. So the CSF can do one of four things. It can continue into a remnant of the ventricular system of the spinal cord, referred to as the central canal. So not a large amount of CSF is going to head actually within the spinal cord region. More CSF, really, the majority of it, will enter the subarachnoid space. So that's kind of key here, is the rest is really going into that subarachnoid spaces. So it can do this via the median and lateral apertures, which are located in the wall of the fourth ventricle. So this allows that CSF to flow in the subarachnoid spaces. Now it can go into the subarachnoid spaces of the cerebellum and around the cerebellum in the spinal cord. And also CSF can exit the apertures to flow into subarachnoid cisterns, which are just larger areas of the subarachnoid space. This will allow CSF to kind of flow in the subarachnoid spaces of the more superior portions of the brain. This is just a cartoonish illustration of the previous flow chart. These shaded areas, I'm going too far ahead. I'm very excited. All right, so this cartoonish illustration, this area right here, these kind of shaded in regions are showing where the ventricles are. So you have your lateral ventricle here. You can see how large it expands. You can see it expanding all the way into this region. Here is your third ventricle flowing through the cerebral aqueduct to get to your fourth ventricle. And you can see the central canal that is moving into or within the spinal cord. Or you can see these holes right here which represent the apertures, so how it's getting into the subarachnoid space to either go through around the spinal cord region, around the cerebellum, and then up into the subarachnoid space up here. All right. Now, when CSF needs to be recycled, it drains into the venous system, specifically into those dural venous sinuses, and it will enter the sinuses through arachnoid granulations. So this is an area in the subarachnoid space, or this is the area with the subarachnoid space with CSF into it in this highly folded complex of arachnoid matter. So subarachnoid space, here's arachnoid that is highly folded, moving into this region, into certain dural venous sinuses, in particularly the superior sagittal sinus. And when it does this, it allows for CSF to drain into the venous system. You can even see in this illustration how there's often a close relationship here to the bone. So where those arachnoid granulations are getting fairly close to the bone, which can cause erosion or pitting of the bone in those regions, referred to as granular fovulae. I wanted to bring up this term lacuna, or lacunae if we're talking about plural, because these are fairly obvious when looking at some of these larger venous sinuses, particularly the superior sagittal sinus. So here's your superior sagittal sinus, which is extending all the way right here. All that the lacunae are lateral expansions of the venous sinuses. So you can see that here and here as outlined. You can even see extending kind of further out in this region. So these are important because these are a common site for arachnoid granulations to extend into. So it's not just directly into the main part of the superior sagittal sinus, it could also move into these lacunae, which are the lateral extensions of the dural venous sinuses. All right, this wraps up our conversation of the ventricles and cerebrospinal fluid. Let's take a minute to review a concept before we finish. Okay, question. A blockage in the cerebral aqueduct would prevent flow of CSF, into which ventricle? Is it A, lateral ventricle, B, third ventricle, C, fourth ventricle? All right, so the correct answer here is going to be C, the fourth ventricle. The cerebral aqueduct is between the third and the fourth ventricles. If you had some form of blockage within the cerebral aqueduct, that would not allow flow into the fourth ventricle. So preventing that flow, you could have a backup of CSF into the ventricles. Recall that the interventricular foramina is going to be, you'll have two of those, and those will allow for CSF flow between the lateral ventricles and the third ventricle. All right, so that should be all for this lecture. After you have reviewed, if you have any questions, please do feel free to reach out. Thank you for your time and attention.